death are linked to overweight or obesity. So this isn't just about vanity. There are real health issues at stake here. If you were to overlay a map of the US, these are obesity rates by state. Green is good. Anyone here from Colorado or Hawaii? Pat on the back. Dark red is very high rates of obesity, over 35%. If you then overlay death rates from heart disease, you can see the pattern. But it's not just heart disease, also cancer. I think someone mentioned earlier this morning, 40% of all cancer diagnoses are associated with being overweight or obese. Real health issues at stake. What's worse is more than half the population of the US are unaware that being overweight or obese can increase the risk of cancer. The CDC came out a couple of years ago and said, obesity increases the risk factors for at least 5, if not 9, diseases. Okay? But despite the fact that we know all of this, it's not getting any better. If you think about children, more than half of all children today will be obese by the time they're 35. As a mother of 2 10-year-olds, that scares me. And my kids are skinny. Am I safe? Are they safe? Not at all. In part because of the built environment, because of the stimuli that are out there for them. And this is not an easy problem to solve. There are a lot of different stakeholders in society who have different roles to play in how you think about the obesity epidemic, different priorities, different needs. And unfortunately for overweight or obesity, it's not so simple as saying what you would say to someone who's struggling with drug abuse or alcohol abuse, just avoid that substance. So we can't avoid food. So what do? We ask my esteemed panelists to come join me on the stage, and we'll talk through it. Gentlemen. All right, thanks everyone. So to my immediate left, we have Jason Langheier, who runs Zipongo, so digital health player. To his left, Randy, CEO of a provider system, who's done some really interesting things with fresh foods. To his left, giant retailer, fair to say, Marcus Osborne from Walmart. Thank you for joining us. I think it's really interesting when we talk about the obesity epidemic, there's kind of a couple of different pillars to the struggle. One is the food access problem, and one is the food swamp. And I think we all kind of want to jump to the swamp, which is kind of the term Esther Dyson has used. But I think it's important to start first with access. Randy, can you tell us a little bit about how you see the problem, what you've done to help combat food deserts in your area?
Sure. So over the last 10 years, our thinking about access has changed. We started with obesity, as you talked about. We actually did learning maps for schools. Put trainers in, and these trainers came back and said, we have a problem. It's not obesity is the problem, it's hunger. And so through a variety of meetings with people in the hunger world, came to the realization 8-9 years ago that hunger is one of these major health issues in our country. We decided to politicize it. And we have these huge issues with you know, having people who know how to eat healthy. So we began to screen people for food insecurity. Where they can sit down and get specific tailored needs or meals to their needs and also to their income. So now that also led us to map food deserts. We did an interview. Again, that's led us a little further along to think about all the social determinants which impact a person's ability to access food. So now we're screening for all 10 social determinants. So our you know, kind of process has been, you
know. Yeah. So, Jason, I'm sorry. I knew you were going to do that. Okay. But the Doritos are far away from me. Not like the Applebee's. It's all about choice. So Marcus and Jason, let's explore kind of the other end of the spectrum where food swamps. How do you think about navigating food swamps and helping consumers think through what are the right choices for them to make?
Yeah, so Marcus will certainly be able to speak to the incredible volume of food that they serve up to people around the world. And I think from the Zipongo perspective, my start in this was starting the pediatric obesity clinic at Boston Medical Center back in 2002, and 50 daily plate today and go home, read these pamphlets, and then come back and eat healthier and you'll be better. And we'll test your labs. That's not very effective, so we created a personalized grocery list for the family. And we took into account the kind of food that kids liked. I hate these vegetables, I'll eat these vegetables, same with the parents. We looked at their budget, we looked at food stamps and what they could apply it to, and we looked at the grocery stores nearby from an access perspective. But by creating the grocery list and actually saying, here, do this for a little while, and we care about the food you like as well and what you can afford, then people just started to do that like a prescription. So the point here isn't about the fact that just that there's not enough access, but there's so much food around everywhere. If you can actually help nudge people and advertise as either a provider, a digital system, or retailer, the better options, that's actually what works really, really well. And I will close by saying that the real challenge is the food swamp that Esther Dyson talks about. There's so not by any evil intent, it's just the way that the industry has evolved is that people are doing their job and food companies just trying to market their product and get it sold. And so they've done a good job with the majority of retailers and saying, here's trade spend, here's a kickback to basically get placement. And they spend billions. But in wellness, for example, we spend millions on incentives. That doesn't hold a candle. What if instead we started spending money to advertise and nudge to the healthy options? And we'd enable now, Zipongo, employers and health systems and health plans, over 200, to do just that.
Yeah, I'd say what is sort of often in the conversations that I have on this issue, what I'll often actually been interesting is I've now sort of come to realize is that fundamentally restriction of choice doesn't actually change consumer behavior. If you look at some of the studies recently on in states that have legalized, for example, marijuana, same thing, per capita consumption has declined. Even in tobacco, you think about the stop selling sort of tobacco, which we did many years ago. We ran a test and we removed all tobacco products in the store. What was interesting in the communities in the state that we did that, consumption didn't decline. In fact, it increased. At the same time, we ran another test. And that test was very simple. We didn't remove tobacco, but we created an alternative that was lower cost. We went out and promoted and marketed a smoking cessation program that was $9 a month. That was $2 cheaper than a pack of cigarettes in that state. And what we saw was a noticeable decline in consumption in that area. And we've seen the same things. And so the example of apples is, I don't know that Sam actually knew this, but it's sort of, there's an interesting story about apples from our perspective. I think most people don't actually know the number one item sold in a Walmart is not apples, but the number one item sold in a Walmart, does anybody want to guess what that is very loudly? Bananas, because I said, so bananas are number one. Apples at the time, many years ago, was not even in the top 10. And we undertook an exercise that said, hey, why are the costs of apples, why are they so expensive? So we basically went out and said, there's a lot of middlemen in the apple business. We went directly to the growers in Washington State and said, we're gonna buy all your product. We're gonna buy all the apples you have. The good ones we're gonna sell directly to consumers as apples. The bad ones, the ones that are sort of beaten up and bruised, we're gonna turn into applesauce or apple juice or whatever it might be. But we'll buy it all, but we want your best price. And so the result was, we were able to significantly reduce the price. What was interesting about that, we didn't tell anybody we were reducing the price. We just did. We didn't put it in our tab. We didn't do ads that said Walmart has dropped the price of apples.
But within weeks of us lowering the price of apples, it went from not even the top 10 to the second most purchased item in our store. And we've learned over time that fundamentally the challenge is, again, not about reducing options, but how do you actually, amongst the options and the plethora of options we have, how do you take the things that if you really want somebody to do something, how do you make them seem better, more valuable, either lower cost or a better perceived value? How do you take the products that you maybe think are unhealthy and actually start to make them better? And so I think we'll talk a little bit more about it, but you're seeing certainly groups, the example that you give, there are a number of health plans that we're involved with in which, as part of programs they're doing, Humana would be one of the biggest, seeing them fund discounts on healthy food purchases, where you tell an individual, you buy these things, I'll pay for 20% of it. And what we know about consumer behavior is we love deals, and we'll seek out deals, and we'll sort of act on those deals. So I think that for us, a lot of the messages is the solutions aren't about sort of restriction. They're actually about taking those things that we want people to do and making those feel like the best value in the market. And some of that's through, again, education and information. Some of it's through pricing. But whatever the means, I think our sense is that we've got to actually create a new approach. It's not about restrictive policy. It's actually about creating kind of clarity in this sea of options.
And is there some tension in your mind? And you know, for folks who don't know me, I spent the first half of my consulting career surveying consumer goods companies, retailers, and I talked about this. And I had my own sort of epiphany one morning where I was meeting with a major beverage company in the morning, talking about getting greater market share with a young demographic, and with the CDC, Division of Nutrition and Physical Activity, in the afternoon, talking about how do we get the sugar out of schools. So when I hear you talking, I want to be a believer, because that means I can have peanut butter cups in my cabinet. So I want to believe it, but is there some tension between kind of the margin associated with sugary, salty foods versus the margin with healthy foods, or is that, in my mind, not a reality?
In reality, that's not a reality. I would tell you, increasingly, the things that are bad for you are the things that the retailers make the least margin on. So, no disrespect, but if you think Walmart or Kroger or whoever has a lot of margin in the sugar, water, and salty snacks, you need to go visit with the groups who manufacture those items. The short answer is no.
It's not there.
Yeah, it's not. And in some ways, it's because they've actually become so proliferated in the market that they've become increasingly marginless. And the irony is that it is sort of things like if you do it well and manage it well, fresh fruit and produce, or think about low-fat dairy or whatever it is that you're trying to be, end up being much more attractive products. And not only that, they are. It is actually those healthy things that that from a consumer perception, when they sort of come in stores like ours, it is those things that actually act as a statement for those retailers.
Yeah.
So I think it's actually the other way. It's increasingly if we had our brothers, those are the things we'd sell because frankly they make us look better visually, and we make more on them. The challenge is there's still a demand for full sugared Coke, and so the issue is, again, how do you sort of create more alternatives? But that's actually probably a perfect example. We have one of the transitions we've seen in grocery. You're now actually selling more ounces of water than you are sugared water today.
I like
and
that.
And that's been a trend that no one's really talking about.
Yeah. So Sam mentioned that we do a lot of consumer research at Oliver Wyman, and there's a refrain that I've been hearing more and more often from chronic disease patients in focus groups and ethnographies, and it's basically this: it's really hard to adhere to the treatment plan, to stick to the diet. I wish the grocery stores would just have an aisle for me. Why can't they just have a CKD patient aisle, or a CHF aisle, or a diabetes aisle? Reactions to that, how do you each think about addressing that need?
Yes, I think one of the broader themes of the day, too, is that the whole world's going to digital. And we've already seen that in music, for a while now. And it's interesting, you probably all noticed that on Pandora or Spotify or whatever, you actually get a choice where you can pay a subscription to shut off the ads. It's pretty cool. No one really likes those ads. But even after you shut off the ads, they personalize the music. They like ask you what are your favorite categories and stuff like that. So there's still ads. It's just a different kind of ads. It's not ads that an advertiser is paying for, but it's ads that Google or Pandora itself are choosing to serve up in their merchandising that keeps you sticky, keeps you wanting to come back because it's personalized and therefore more useful to you. We are at that same moment in time with food, and this is our opportunity. And I say our opportunity because it's the health plans, the employers who are health plans, and the health systems who have the opportunity to reshape this moment in time in partnership with the retailers. And I think Marcus also nicely laid out, I mean, they're the largest grocer in the world, a retailer. And they have so much power to go to the growers directly, disintermediate the chain, manipulate prices. By the way, Oliver Wyman has a great margin engineering practice, and I learned really quickly as a consultant at Oliver Wyman how influential everything Marcus just said really, truly is. But with this new digital moment in time, it's growing a lot faster. Ready for pickup at Walmart is amazing. People love that service. They just have to discover it, just like we did with Uber and Lyft and all these other things. But here's the thing. If your job is to be paid as an advertiser or marketer at Hershey's, it's your job to figure out how to still be relevant and to still maintain impulse buying that causes a lot of purchases of your product. That's just their job. So they're thinking, well, I want to go to Amazon, I want to go to Instacart, I'm going to pay them to put it right out at checkout, just like I have put it out at the checkout aisle before, because that's their job. But your job, our job, is to do the opposite. Because when we do the opposite and we nudge people to an extra apple, you're going to get better health outcomes and you're going to pay less money. And that's incredibly clear in the studies. So when everybody, that's not super easy. Except in digital, it is pretty easy, in quotes, to ask somebody, what are your food preferences? Well, I'm gluten-free, I want paleo, I want this. But bringing them back to a whole food plant-based diet or plant-forward and all the literature that goes behind what actually matters for different disease states, that's very doable in a digital environment. You can nudge people to the right options. You can help fund that to overload the funding that comes from the food industry.
Yeah, it's interesting that when we screen for social determinants, we ask motivational questions. And I think predictably people think that people aren't motivated. Actually, the numbers are like 80, 90% of people are motivated to change their lives. They just don't know how. So it's interesting, I think from a healthcare perspective, you know, 3 years ago, if you went to a conference, you wouldn't hear the word social determinants. Now everybody says they're doing something. They may sponsor a farmer's market or something like that. But the opportunity to really integrate all these social determinants, especially hunger as a basic issue in life, kind of into this whole discussion. So I think, from a healthcare, how it's evolved in our country, we view everybody as a patient. You didn't get up this morning viewing yourself as a patient. And so for our whole history as a country, we've thought of people as that. You come in, we're going to treat you clinically. We didn't do it holistically. And so these dialogues with, the folks that are sitting here, they just didn't happen. So now you have the opportunity to kind of think, take healthcare, for the right reasons, and the reason we can't afford what we're doing, we've got to change it to a much more socially based model, to think cooperatively with other people, look at tools, to be able to help us all kind of live the lives we want, make healthy choices, have it tailored to our needs. So I think for the first time, I think because we can't afford the current system, I think what we just heard from the last speaker, now is the time to really think of things differently, really kind of create those tools people need in life to really live the kind of life they really want to live.
And I'd go back to my original story. We've done a number of programs with groups, but one I'll sort of share with you was one we did with Cerner and a couple other entities in Missouri in this town. So it was targeted, they called it Healthy Nevada, and it was an attempt to kind of get the community to be improve the overall health, and there was a specific focus on diabetics. And so one of the things we did was we actually did create in that store a full diabetic area and aisle, and I would say it's wildly successful. It performed well, the store performed well because of it. You saw benefits in the community. We went back really excited to the individual who was running grocery time and said, you know, look at this. And he goes, let me show you the letters I got, though. And there are letters from other people who were saying, well, I'm not diabetic, I'm hypertensive, or I have a gluten intolerance, or I have a lack of, like, why in the hell don't you have an aisle for me? And so we said, well, this will be a fun little exercise. Let's go sort of take the top 20 issues that not just on the cusp, I think we've actually already gone an environment that we think will actually define not just retail, but healthcare.
Yeah.
This is a perfect example that why do I need to create a special aisle? Why don't I essentially let technology convert the store for you? I mean, including the sort of idea, it sounds kind of strange, but you know, next generation Oculus that says I'm going to press a button that says, I want me to get an A1C that's 10% lower. We're actually already there. And I think so our sense is we're already seeing those sort of technologies deployed. I think the challenge is, how do we, they're in the hands of the few right now, that in some ways the mass proliferation of digital health technology, there's so much that I think consumers and increasingly providers and health systems are overwhelmed. And so I think our bigger challenge is what we call the kind of digital health marketplace issue, which is based on my needs, how do I sort of connect you with the solutions that are best sort of adapted and targeted to you? I don't think we figured that one out. I think that's probably the next big challenge, but what we're already seeing is we're already there. And I think technology, this is a good example where technology is can be a savior.
I love it.
I would add the concern, I think, from a healthcare perspective, it's still very rare to see people interested in social determinants. It's still rare for people. I think we're paying a lot of lip service to it. Whether or not it gets some traction, I think that really, hopefully, from payers, and that's how there needs to be some pressure. I think just what you heard right before us, to make the industry change, and I don't think that's going to come naturally.
Let's shift our focus a little bit and talk about sort of the funding side of this and food as true medicine. Medicare Advantage has said, you know, we're okay paying for food. What do you each think that means in terms of the opportunities it presents, but also the challenges and kind of playing that through?
Yeah, I think it's incredibly exciting and surprising, frankly, what happened earlier this year, which is that CMS released a call letter and said, okay, Medicare Advantage plans, you can choose to pay for food. And they gave the example of 4 weeks following discharge from the hospital, or 2 weeks if a person has chronic disease. Then what's even more shocking is that they did what I think is the right thing and came out with a revision of that call letter and said, oh, by the way, you can't just do any food or the cheapest food, because let's be honest, I mean, and this is a forcing function, nobody wants to be left behind in 2020 when your competitor Medicare Advantage plan is offering food as part of their benefit and they can advertise it for enrollment. Nobody wants to not have that, because you will lose market share. So there's the enrollment and retention side of offering food as a perk, just like Silver Sneakers and Tivity does with gym benefit. But the other side of it is, and again, I give a lot of credit to CMS, like, hey, but we don't want to serve up unhealthy, cheap food just to attract people to the plan. You need to have a provider prescribe the food It needs to include a personalized meal plan, and it has to be medically tailored with some hope of actually improving the disease states that this individual might have on Medicare Advantage. That's amazing, if you think about it, that they're thinking about it holistically, but not easy to do. So I think it does create a little bit of that pressure. And the fresh food pharmacies have been amazing, and I should talk about some of the results you've seen. Our chief medical officer, Dexter Sherney, is from the gamut at Blue Cross Blue Shield Michigan, chief medical officer there, Healthways at Cummins, at Amgen, so he's seen these different walks of life. But when he was at Vanderbilt as a professor, he published that you could ostensibly get people off of their diabetes medications, like $4,000 drugs like Farxiga. You could reverse their hypertension, and you could get them off really expensive autoimmune disease-oriented specialty pharma drugs. This is not pseudoscience. I know we still put food as medicine almost in this alternative medicine category, but it's not. The data is incredibly robust, and it should be treated with the same rigor and value actuarially as drugs. And in an era where now you kind of have to do it as a Medicare Advantage plan, or else you're going to be left behind for the enrollment and loyalty reasons, you might as well make it work for you too to lower your costs.
Yeah, you know, I think when you start looking at how you're going to change people's behaviors, you know, especially in healthcare, they're going to change if they get paid differently. So if it's mandated, we'll do it. Our experience in food pharmacies, if patients screen positive for food insecurity and they go to a food pharmacy versus those that don't, the difference in costs just for food, sitting down with a pharmacist, getting healthy recipes, talking about how to live off your budget, the cost difference per member per month is 15%. So just for food. So if you begin to start thinking about that and some of the other social determinants, and the idea that not only do we want to do that for patients, but then the next step is for employers to do that and think about it from an employer standpoint. If we're able to start doing that, because it's the right thing to do, and then again, I think your idea about, you know, hunger's a health issue, like, yeah, that's, you know, something that we're really not interested in. Just start to read the health impacts on kids, the development of children, and what it does to their development, and what it does to their, you know, cognitive development and that abilities, and what that impacts in lifelong. And you start looking at all those things, and it's kind of like, why in the heck didn't we do this sooner, and why did we mandate it sooner? And again, it's just not been integrated into the clinical mindset of healthcare.
Yeah, I guess I would say that particularly plans or employer groups that don't think there is a return on investment to, you know, encourage and drive healthy eating, then you clearly just aren't reading the literature. You're almost sort of ignoring reality. I think you're probably too massively influenced by the pharmaceutical industry who is led you to believe that drugs are the savior for everything. And, you know, you look at, certainly groups that we are getting, Geisinger, you mentioned Humana and others, I think it was about a year and a half ago, Humana published, you know, it's now their GO365 program, previously called Vitality. Certainly know the results of what occurred in South Africa, but they basically generated the same results here, which were helping fund what I would consider to be marginal discounts on healthy foods. It led to reductions in things that are almost unexplainable. The individuals who were engaging these programs and were using the discounts to buy healthier foods saw very significant reductions in their ER utilization almost immediately. I mean, this is not things that took years to generate return on investment. The return on investment was almost overnight. I don't know that we entirely, you know, some of it is, you know, we'll kind of learn more, but you're seeing those same results. The second thing that you saw, if you're a health plan, particularly Medicare Advantage, or if you, you know, whatever it might be, you're worried about member retention. Well, you saw the same thing. Individuals who you offer these programs up, they really didn't cost that much. Very significant improvement in member retention and recruitment.
And these are two metrics that people care a lot about.
You should. That's like a figure. If you're in the insurance industry, what you care about is, yeah, you make money when people pay premiums and they don't use the ERs and other providers. And you make money when people keep coming back and paying their premiums. So I don't know much about your business, but I'm pretty confident that's it, right? Like, if people pay premiums and keep paying the premiums and then don't ever use those premium dollars on healthcare spending, like, it's a genius plan, right? And it seems to me that that's, you know, you're increasingly seeing those are the results, which are increased retention and reduction in medical spend for what I consider to be kind of marginal spend on you know, kind of supporting these healthy eating initiatives. So my hope is, I know it probably feels weird or hippie or I don't know what it is, but my view is just look at the data, look at the facts, and then build the plan around what seems to be working. So, and I think increasingly, all the data seems to indicate the clear benefit, clear returns that are there.
And the other thing we don't have time to talk about today is seniors, you know, filing bankruptcy at an all-time high, you know, number of people turning 85. Loneliness, isolation, the inability to get healthy food, the impacts on seniors living longer. Just another huge issue. We talked about children, but seniors as well, especially as you look at this silver tsunami that we're facing in the next 5 years. A very big issue, again, when you think about health and hunger's culture.
I was going to say, I mean, I think one of the issues that you both highlighted that you all think about when you have to go back to your incredible laundry list of things you have to get done. Okay, so there's a forcing function of Medicare Advantage where there's this bid that's going to be due in June. So I know people are taking a look at that, but realistically, how do you engage with this complicated system of providers, the payers, or how do you implement something like this, especially for people who are sick, where you do have clinical standards of care? And I think the opportunity is, we have a program called Food Scripts, and to give you an example, one of our users named Teresa, she is a patient access rep at a large health system in Louisiana. She started using the platform that was introduced to her by both her wellness platform and her physician. And the physician effectively prescribed kind of this food script, and she actually dropped 60 pounds. You know, it's a classic Weight Watcher stories, but she lost 60 pounds. The only difference is 2 years later, she's now lost 100 pounds. So it's about the retention and the continued benefit, because most people gain the weight back after a year. And the reason she's continued to lose weight and stayed off $4,000 a year for Farxiga and $1,000 a year with hypertension meds is because she switched the way she buys her food. She switched the recipes that she cooks. And she keeps doing that. It's not like you stop buying your food, and when you buy through a certain portal, you keep buying through that portal. So that was all initiated through a wellness platform and a doctor. It happened to be both in her case. But you guys have that power. And to Marcus's point, you know, for the full population, we're talking nominal fees. And for, you know, people who are sick, again, on $4,000 medication for diabetes, and it costs you, you know, $500. There's a really simple ROI equation there, and it's really low risk. And the last thing I'd say is that sometimes I hear health plans say, it's not my job to pay for food, and that's such a slippery slope. And you're right to worry about that. I actually empathize, like, as a data scientist, as your actuaries, you have to worry about that and think about it. But if you put it in the form of a prescription for people who are sick, they're both going to really appreciate you and value that you care to think about them holistically, not just as people that you're going to give a pill. And you can measure the results in the same way as you do with your drug trials.
Any final thoughts, Marcus? Awesome. Well, thank you all for joining. I really appreciate your time tonight.